Billy Corgan, welcome to Talk Asia.
William now.
William Corgan. Yeah, William Corgan. When did that change?
I've been morphing for a while. So.
Really?
Yeah, I'm going to go William now.
Do you feel more serious?
No, it's just that's actually my birth name.
Do you feel more grown up, though?
No. Just Billy gets uncomfortable at some point.
Really?
Like wrinkles and Billy, it's just...
What do you believe has been the means to the success or the longevity of the Smashing Pumpkins? I mean, we look back from the formation in 1988 to, you know, Gish in 91, and now Oceania today. Mm. What do you think has been the means for its longevity?
Well, I have a saying, which is crazy is good for business. I think rock and roll really is about being a bit crazy, and that sounds like a line from a Scorpion song, but like crazy. It's not a corporate thing. It's been turned into a corporate thing, but really, people like me, you can't invent people like me. We kind of come out of weird places and strange backgrounds, and we can't be sort of prototyped or copied. If you would ask me, you know, the 20-year-old me about the kind of album I've made on Oceania, the 20-year-old me says some of it's boring, but sometimes it takes those spaces and the kind of quietude to find something else. And I think we all go through that as we get a little bit older. We look for sort of different simplicities. And there's a simplicity in Oceania that my earlier work doesn't have, where I was sort of intent on constantly proving something.
I guess I read that you approached it from actually a place of being happier than you have been in a while. Is that?
Did I say that?
Was that not true?
No, it's true.
But does that in itself pose challenges when it comes to songwriting?
There's a long established concept that gets bandied about, which is misery makes for great art. Mm-hmm. And I actually think this is, if we were asking a Shinto monk, I think they would laugh at this idea.
Yeah.
Because you're basically saying suffering's good for business. And I don't think suffering's good for business. Crazy is good for business. Suffering isn't. I think suffering or the gestalt of here I am ripping my heart open, I think that lasts for about two or three albums. Mm. At some point you have to mature into the deeper work.
So what are you exploring now?
God. A big American magazine was doing a thing called The Future of Rock.
Yeah.
And you know, they asked 50 artists, what's the future of rock? And my answer was God. And they said, what do you mean? And I said, well, God's the third rail of, like they say, Social Security is the third rail of politics in America. Well, God is the third rail in rock and roll. You're not supposed to talk about God, even though most of the world believes in God. Mm. It's sort of like, don't go there. I think God's the great unexplored territory in rock and roll music. And I actually said that. I thought it was perfectly poised. And of course, they didn't put it in.
Well, what would you say to Christian rockers then?
Make better music. Personally, my opinion, I think Jesus would like better bands, you know? Now I'm going to get a bunch of Christian rock hate mail.
But that's interesting.
Put it this way. Here's a better quote.
Yeah.
Hey, Christian rock, if you want to be good, stop copying U2. U2 already did it. You know what I mean? There's a lot of U2-esque Christian rock.
Sure.
Bono and company created the template for modern Christian rock, and I'd like to think Jesus would want us all to evolve.
I'm curious about the single Pale Horse. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering what the origin of the title of Pale Horse was. Did it come from, and this is just my interpretation, but did it come from
it's like Trainspotting.
the New Testament, Bible, with the four horsemen of the apocalypse. Mm. The last horse is the pale horse.
I had no idea.
Which symbolizes death.
Had no idea. But in your sentient intuition, what you did pick up on is that it's a song about my mother.
Yeah.
And it's really about the point where my mother left my life at around 4 years old. So it is really reflective of death. Symbolic, not literal. And of course, she later died when I was 29 from cancer. So I had two losses, losing her as a mother and losing her as a friend. So the song sort of deals with that, but I had no idea.
So when you look back at the albums that you have created, such as multi-platinum albums like Siamese Dream,
right?
Melancholy and Infinite Sadness, what are your interpretations of that time now?
I see them as faithful postcards to where I was.
Songs like Today from Siamese Dream.
Right.
1979 from Melancholy.
Right. I did write
Zero.
Those.
those kind of songs. Those are important indicators of the certain emotion that was, at least that you felt at that time.
Yeah.
What are your memories of your life at that time?
I was miserable. I was totally miserable. So I was operating off of more of an idealism, like who I wanted to be or who I wished I was.
Yeah.
Because who I really was or how I felt I was miserable.
See, you know, there's some shrinks out there who would say, and bear with me on this one.
Have you been to a shrink?
Well, haven't we all? There's some shrinks out there who would say that the people that we are connected to, mm-hmm. or we find ourselves connected to, are there to help us reconcile certain issues.
Karmic or, wounds.
Yeah. And the people that we are most intimate with, whether our partners, bandmates, they're there to help you recognize and work through those issues.
Right.
Is that what the Pumpkins were for you, the original band?
No.
No?
No, we were four strangers who agreed on a musical vision. And we did more harm than good.
In what way?
It was destructive.
But then some could say, well, if you look back at your, say, when you were growing up, same kind of dysfunction, right?
True. True.
What did you learn from about yourself in that experience?
Which one?
The first band experience.
I would say the key experience for me from the original version of Smashing Pumpkins was what is loyalty? Mm. What is loyalty? Because I had a false concept of loyalty, and I rode that ship all the way to the bottom. When most people, wiser than I, would have jumped off the ship when it was to their benefit. Mm. So people always say, what's your greatest career regret? It's when the band blew up in 96 that I didn't jump off and make a new ship. I rode that ship all the way to the bottom.
What about when it comes to what you learned about yourself from your family?
False loyalty.
Again.
I think a lot of people really struggle with false loyalty.
I read that your dad said that you'd saved his life on many occasions.
He's being generous.
That there was an article where he was quoted as saying that I grew up in a house of no love or emotion, and it kind of sticks with you. You end up passing it on to your kids. Is that?
It's fairly accurate.
Really?
Yeah. Accurate.
When did you finally feel, or have you, a sense of stability in your life?
Never.
Never.
Never. No. I've invested in one particular concept, and it's, I would say, it's a wash. Mm. I'm happy to have done what I've done. I feel privileged to have communicated, blessed to have been recognized where many people don't.
Yeah.
But yeah, personally devastating.
So we have this side of William Corgan. Then we have the other side
as
well.
She's a really good interviewer. I like this.
Where we have the tea drinking, tea shop owning, and pro wrestling loving man.
Boy child.
Very different elements, or are they the same?
Same.
Pro wrestling, what's that about?
It's fun.
See, you do have fun.
Yeah,
in
quiet moments. when no one's watching.
William, Billy Corgan.
That's where you say goodbye.
Thank you for your time.
Sure.